All right, so, okay, 5 lectures left. We're gonna talk about some fun things, is the idea, or interesting things. You know, no need new coursework at this point. So I'm gonna talk about organizations today, right? So how do you build organizations that are able to innovate, able to rescue themselves from disaster? These, basically those sort of two concepts. I'll talk about them in different ways, but that's the general idea. How do you make organizations that are really good at doing one thing? What's that organization? What are the ones that can dig themselves out? And all right, so this is a very profound kind of problem. We'll get to it in a little bit. Okay, so I'll go through a few random things. So I have been adding tarot cards, right? So this is the centrality one, so the unveiling of hidden powers. And then this was waiting to be done, the scrying for the shapes of things. So that's yeah, look, there's an adjacency matrix that's been sorted in a, yeah, okay. It's just wrong. let's see. Yeah. Unless I do the special topics, which apparently, this is good. This is important. We've studied a lot about contagion. No evidence for contagious. It's a good question. It was a good question. Someone asked this question. It is one of those things where you think, did they ask this question first or what happened? Just spending too much time with the lemurs, maybe. But it comes from this. I got to it from Tadeo, who spoke here last year, which was escapees from the file drawer problem. Like, okay, I'm glad someone solved that. Okay, I want to show you this. I'm going to show you this. I showed you a little bit of this the other day, but this is the high quality output we have from the UVM Complex Systems Center. Sorry, all the noise. Hilarious. Also in, oh, look at that terrible, yeah, come on, give us that, that's 1440. Look at that, nice. Okay, so we've got an intro for our things, for like 3 talks this semester. Egregious. Good, yeah. So that was an important addition. Yes, thank you, my time, which I've spent. Yeah, anyway, good things, and I think, and we'll have all the others up, and the others I'm going to show you as we go along. All right, good, good, good. Other tweeters? Are there other tweeters? That's enough. Okay, good. Yeah, the multi-layer networks, which we haven't really talked about in this class, there's a thing of the physics of it, but it's a bit thin, actually. There are many other things there. I mean, the classic example now seems to be the power grid with the communication system on top. There's a lot more coming, so I might wait on that one. All right, so we're gonna talk about organizations. Let's, what is that? I don't even know what that is. What is that thing? Can anyone explain to me what that rectangle of death is all, what is it? Oh God, it is, that's what it is, isn't it? It's trying to, it wants me to answer something. Adobe, you're the worst. Ugh. Okay. Sorry, I'm just gonna destroy something. Ooh. Really? Is that what is going on with this thing? Okay. What's the best way to kill this at the point? I think it. Yeah, I want to do that. It just feels like I would kill a lot of things. Okay, so, but that's fun. Yeah. One of my favorite commands, Acrobat. Oh, come on. You can see it. But why does it, will it need all of that? Like this?
Yeah.
All right. I'm gonna have to edit this out. Well, it just totally choked, didn't it? It's still dead too. So one way to do this is just to go, okay. This guy. All right, now you can die. Die. I'll leave you there for more. destruction. Unbelievable. What is this thing called again? Thank you. Wow, that really exploded into a ball of flames. And of course it appears on the wrong screen. All right. Okay. Let's be like, talk about the first slide and then we're finished. All right, there's a Monty Python skit where you have to summarize Proust's work in 15 seconds. And there's one where they just, on the first day he wrote about, and that's all they managed to sing, basically. Sorry. What's that? That, oh yeah, well, no, I just wasn't deft enough with my kill all abilities. Right, there's an XKCD on tar, right? Yeah? Right, the world's going to explode unless someone types a tar command cleanly without any mistakes into this prompt, and then someone says, I know Unix, and there's like, I'm so sorry. Okay, just a basic trap, just nothing else, just type it in correctly. Okay, so it's going to be, so this is going to be a very general thing about, you're trying to build a group of people, and we're not even going to think about the computer part, socio-technical computation that's there, but you've got all these people in an organization, they're communicating in some way, we're going to have to do it pretty abstractly. There's the classic notion of a hierarchy, right? We have that over and over again, or at least the notion of it. So how do we set up things that can solve, set up groups of people so they can solve problems that are difficult? There are routine kind of problems you have to solve over and over, that's fine, but then there are ones that you've just never seen before. And also to be able to recover from really, you know, big attacks or big failures, whatever it is. So I'll get to a model. This work, this is a paper that was published in PNAS in 2003, but we'll get to that. I'm going to talk about some other stuff first, of course, right? So we'll think about it in a sense of information exchange, right? You're passing messages around, and you know, some of those message packets may be about, I've got this problem, you know, and that message has to find its way to the right person who knows about hummingbirds, right? But it could be because you've got a problem with hummingbirds, right? But it could be you don't even know what a hummingbird is, so you kind of have to describe this thing that's kind of flappy and small and likes juice or something, you know, and like you sort of say that, and then eventually someone else in the organization says, oh, it's a hummingbird, right? You just do that, you know. So there are these various levels of problems, and we'll sort of cater to all of them. One is you know what the problem is. You know exactly what the problem is, right? This hummingbird won't get out of my office. Or you don't even know. You can't even tell there's a hummingbird in your office. You have no idea. You just know that things aren't working anymore, like that Adobe thing. So then there's this second layer, and we'll get to this term of ultra-robustness, which is just us overreaching, I suppose. But, you know, robust in a couple of senses, and then, you know, one of them being able to handle message passing under stress, and the next is catastrophe recovery. So something bad has happened to your organization, some aspect of it. And Toyota will be our defining example, actually. So ill-defined problems, right, where we don't even know the word hummingbird. And it's sort of a design feature that we're trying to get to. So how do you structure things? So this is fun. So this is one of these problems too where we sit down, it's like a lot of these little toy models of social phenomena or kind of any system, but where you struggle to find a good toy model that will tell you, not the story you're looking for, but will kind of show you new stories in a way that you can understand eventually, right? This is again, Schelling model. The Schelling model is the sort of the paradigm of this where it tells a different story that no one could really kind of honestly see before they saw this new dynamic playing out because we don't understand the stories of groups very well at all. Okay. All right. So, okay, yes, this thing. So we're going to have something that we built. We have to build these networks. We want to think about them growing over time. And we have this sort of notion of a startup being this little group of people who are all talking and then it maybe become a big thing and then there are hierarchies, and then someone who's the oldest sibling kind of person becomes the CEO, and you know they keep it the same or whatever it is, right? And there are lots of serious board meetings and things, but to start with, it's fun, right? So, how do you kind of keep all that happening? It's an extremely interesting problem. I mean, you see places like Google and Facebook trying to keep these things alive, right, and sort of innovative and. You see, the military does this, you see, right? Lots of, in fact, a lot of organizational theory comes out of the military because it is literally life or death. It's not just money, right? So, and so they really have to figure this out, right? How do you set things up? So you end up with stuff like the Marines, right? So you have three, one. What are the names of the things, right? Three, one, and then three groups of four, and then one on top, so it's 13, and then three groups of 13, and one on top, that's 40, right? So that's a little hierarchical structure, but they can all be broken off into pieces. I don't want to say the who's what in that thing, because I'll know I'll mess it up. That's what we should have, three graduate students for every postdoc. Actually, I'm sort of serious about that. And then we'll do some performance measures, right? We'll get our little network out, and we'll beat it with a stick, and see if it holds up, and we'll make it talk a lot, try to solve problems, and I'll see what I can tell you. All right, so Toyota. So Aishin was a, so this was a bad system. So Toyota actually is this whole hierarchy, from what I understand, of sort of all sorts of companies underneath it that collaborate in different ways. You know, they're independent companies, they make different things, lots of contracts between them. And they do things like move engineers between them as well, so that's a sort of a good, healthy, you know, thing to do with the ecology of their system. They had a fair bit of robustness, and this is the late 90s. They did have all of their brake valves being made in pretty much one place, which is not a good plan, right? I mean, this is one of these things where if someone had given you the whole blueprint of everything, and then you should be able to feed it into an algorithm, and then it should pop out and say, that's a bit dangerous, right? You know, Amazon, for example, has, what, three places at least for everything? It's distributed around the globe, right? Because it's not good if it's all in one place and goes foomph. I mean, if you have 30 time capsules and you think you're awesome because they're all at home and it swaps between them all and the whole thing goes foomph, it's not good. So you need, yeah. And just in the same sense, you need to be able to, same with sports teams, right? You need to be able to sub in someone else if, you know, yeah. Steph Curry is a bad, right? Okay, so... now, also Toyota had done all sorts of innovation over the years, right? And I guess since then they've gotten into trouble for some other kinds of innovation, but that's what car manufacturers seem to do. What was the GM one, right? They paid for a slightly cheaper starter thing, which led to, right? Yeah, just slight, I mean, it fit the same thing, didn't look really different, but they didn't tell anyone it was different. That was their extra special trick. Okay. Okay, so just in time. This comes from Toyota, from what I understand, which is that you don't have 6 months of tires and whatever, you don't have all that stuff, or sort of differential backups, like some things, maybe you get them in reserve, right? It's a just-in-time situation. So you've got all these things being made all at the same time. This is a dangerous feature. Now, if you've got lots of threads coming in, right? So in this case, these brake parts coming in from lots of different places, you know, and you've done something where you've moved away from rail as well. So you've got trucks, you know, all these things could fail in small ways, but not globally. But here we have, at least they had, I'm sure they're probably worried about it. I don't exactly know. But this thing been on the ground, very specialized machines, and it's just gone, right? It's just gone, boop, so you've lost your whole system. So they completely stopped, right? Zero cars. And this is a huge deal. I mean, it's a big, certainly then at the time, a big part of Japan's economy. So the initial estimates would take 6 months to get all this back, and they're very specialized machines. So that was a huge problem. You didn't just go to Walmart and buy another one, right? Or go to Amazon, get another one. Actually, no one trusted Amazon then. Anyway, so they had to basically build these new machines from scratch. Someone had a blueprint so they could do it, but there were no just-in-time for the machines. Right? But they recovered in 5 days, so they were back to full production in 5 days. There really was zero, I think, on that first day. So there is a paper on this that was at least instrumental for us, and I think it's been generally well regarded. This is 1999, I should say that. But there we go, the words, fractal design. It's a little bit, not quite. And self-organized, I mean, it's great, right? It's great, got the words. They should have put chaos in there, but they didn't, okay. overcomes chaos, something. And then complexity, sure, you could do that. Fractal complex design, we could really make that better. Okay, so, but it was basically looking at this as a case study, like how did they do this, right? How did they save themselves? So, because they weren't designed, you know, they didn't have, no one had written down, well, what happens if this explicitly, I mean, people have contingencies, but you know, nothing explicit about this. So it ended up after 5 days that there were 36 suppliers. So there, as I said, all these independent companies that are all tied to Toyota, their livelihoods absolutely depend on Toyota, but there's this whole spectrum of companies. And all these individuals and all these other subcontractors, they got involved. So they ended up with all these supply lines. So the motivation was enormous for them, right? I mean, this is a disaster. And it would actually, you know, if it really went down to zero for 6 months, then that would really put a dent in Japan's economy. And of course, locally for these people would destroy them. What's that? I mean, it was just a disaster, yeah. So we included, and there's a little anecdote in there of a sewing machine maker who's just a friend of, or maybe a relative of someone involved. Just, they said, okay, I can make some things. So I guess someone's car has a brake part that was made in some sort of retooled sewing machine, which sounds dangerous. Okay, so yeah, it was a milling machine, but there you go. So they started to make some, helping out, everyone helped out, right? So huge motivation, but pretty great problem solving. And it wasn't that Toyota said, you have to do this, and you have to do this, and you have to do this, right? All these people essentially came together, all these companies came together and figured out how to do it, spread the information across. Now the web exists, you've got email, so there's an opening up of communications in that sense. Probably a few faxes were involved. But it had a couple of things that sort of are inspirational. So robustness, this idea of robustness that generally speaking, you know, this, it's going along, it's got this just-in-time thing, there's lots of clever things built into Toyota that make it work. But it's functioning pretty well, and then when it takes a big hit, it's robust in that next kind of level, right? It can pull itself out of this disastrous situation. And there's a searchability, which we've talked about. We had the small world search and contagion sort of allied to search in general, but you know, they're able to find people and talk to people and figure things out. Wow, you should totally go into business, just crush it. I don't know, Survivor probably hadn't been on TV for long enough, but maybe, I mean, maybe. I don't think they had time, they didn't time, it just went boom, and you know, yeah, that would, but that's pretty great. Right, so there are a million details that I'm sure I don't know about, but that will change the way you play the game. But I think it was also just too quick for that evilness to happen. When something like, what was it called? The flash crash, was it? What was the name of the company out in New Jersey who had a rogue algorithm night, right? Yeah, didn't they all get bought up by someone else immediately? That was a different thing, but they're just like, we'll take you. It is? It resurfaced? Okay.
Yeah, Knight, it declared bankruptcy and then through restructuring bankruptcy, now it's KCG Holding, which is not the same thing as Knight Capital Group.
Got to go to the acronym, yeah. KFC. Yeah. It's the best. love it. Yeah. Okay, so speaking of things that explode, this is a picture I took at my home because, in fact, my father-in-law, did he work for Lehman Brothers? He worked for Solomon in the 80s, which was an interesting place to be, but this is all we have left. so some things do explode, right? So when you think about social institutions, religions do pretty well, like the big ones last for a long time. There are little cults that come and go, sometimes because they will kill themselves with purple robes or something, because there's a comet coming. So, but they're usually small numbers. They're not good stories. Anyway, so, but cities stay around for a long time. Cities seem to last enormously. There are a few ghost towns, but cities, you know, they go through all sorts of things. You know, I think Rome was down to 30,000 people or something like that in the middle of the second millennium, and, you know, now it's still there. But it's hard to get rid of these things, or for these things to get rid of themselves. Sometimes they try very hard. But corporations, they can really explode. Countries are more flexible, I have to say. The cities do much better than the countries, right? The borders, as we've looked at, right? They're a little more subject to, you know, change. Which is interesting, yeah? I mean, countries have changed a lot more, but the cities, you know, maybe some renaming, you know, Stalingrad, St. Petersburg, Constantinople, what's the, you know, still there. Okay, so this place, you know, I think I had to do that because of low quality, but the creston, the joy of the creston, look at that, that's just so great. Couldn't read it on the previous ones. Sorry, I'm just reveling in technology. This is a little detail from Despicable Me, when he goes to get a loan for his evil things, Steve Carell. This is just this nice little Easter egg for us, right there, yeah. Okay, so it's still here, is what I'm trying to say. But at least in, okay, so let's talk about problems. Okay, so catastrophe happens. It might be that for some reason people can't communicate, you know, some portion can't communicate with each other. It could be a manufacturing thing, as we've talked about with Toyota. And there are lots of different things that can happen. You know, it could be a data loss right now. That's a huge potential disaster. So they're unexpected. You're right, these are the, well, what could we get into? The sort of known unknowns and the unknown unknowns kind of world a little bit, right? So. Things that haven't happened before, which is always fun, they're ambiguous. Like you're not, once you start to get a hold on it, you know there's some feathers involved and maybe a beak. And this is really hard. We'll get at this a little bit, but distributed. You need, I mean, ultimately figuring out how, you've got a big corporation, how do you get 15 people together who can solve this problem, right? You may have a problem that just transcends any one person. And so it could be that, so there are many problems where you can't do it locally. Somehow you have to find someone in your corporation, it's a search problem, who can help you. And some corporations are very, you know, they want you to stay within the team a little bit, right? Yeah, you go and exhaust the Wikipedia first. But, you know, it's a problem like that. But maybe you need a team of six people who would have different specialties. You need a band, right? You need the drummer, you need that, right? So you need a team. So how do you get those people together to solve the problem? That's harder. Of course, you have what's just sitting there right now. This is you know, usually what you need as well. There's some motivation to get it done. You don't just look for the exits. That happens too. yeah, I mean, some just get right. Enron just gone. Yeah. Okay. So this is sort of this is ambiguous in itself, which is a problem, right? So how do you create things, how do you create a model where you have ambiguous problems, sort of, right? And that somehow you are collective. Obviously, we have to, so I have to say, we probably went through about 15 different models and ideas and craziness. I mean, one I remember was, let's say we have a network of people and it's a, and the way they're connected is just through a tree, right? We just have a tree connecting them. But you needed, for the problem that you have now, they need to be connected in a different tree. So how would you start, like, how long will it take you to move from that configuration to this configuration? I mean, this is sort of abstractly, right? So how easily could this system reconfigure itself so the right people are connected with each other? It can't be the Marine. The Army, I think, years ago when they first started to get chest up kind of computer systems, right? They realized everyone could talk to everyone at the same time. So you go from the, right? It's one of these transitions. You go from a sort of a sparse, rare, low kind of thing to a completely abundant situation where you have a different kind of problem, right? So now you could have comms open to everyone all the time, which is obviously a disaster, right? So, which is the internet, basically. how do you do it so that you have them kind of restricted, but then can be flexible? Like, actually, now you guys need to talk to these guys, right? So how do you do that? Hard problem. Okay, so ambiguity. So sometimes we don't even know what the question is. And maybe there's a whole iterative process of, I mean, this is also research, right? Research is sort of basically kind of this, but this is a kind of fear-based research. Sort of this iterative thing. And this is a big deal for when we think about organizations. Once you've decomposed the problem into pieces, you know, you need someone to study the beak and the feathers and whatever, and you know their feathers, and then they're going to come back and say, I think it's part of a hummingbird or whatever it is. You know, you can decompose the problem. You've already solved an enormous part of the problem. You've chunked it, right? And this happens with, you know, code kinds of problems as well. Can you split it up, you know, and parallelize the thing? Can you do that? It means you know a lot about it already. Or is it inherently everything has to talk to each other? Right, there's a whole supercomputing kind of variation of this as well. How do you get people? Yes, so how does this happen? And I think I might have it. I think it was Honda. I think Honda had this, and maybe Toyota did as well, and I'm sure many places have done it, but I think they pioneered this idea, and I don't know what the name is, which was where if there was a problem arose, they would have kind of a rule, so a meta rule where you bring 15 or 20 people together. So something exploded over here, 15 or 20 people come in, and you actively get people who you think will definitely help, but then people from all around the organization. So you bring in completely random, seemingly random people. Solve the problem, takes 3 or 4 days, whatever it is, and then everyone they write down how they solved it. So you start to build institutional memory of solving weird problems or unexpected problems. And it also creates a way of gluing people together. I mean, to some extent, committees do that, you know, within boring places like academia where you get all these people together and they sit there and, you know, keep each other awake. so how do we define this? All right, so it's hard. It's a hard thing to do, obviously. Where's my spoon? I need a spoon. This is a fun problem. So you need to be finding information from others, right? And so somehow they need to be reaching out beyond their local contacts, and you need some sort of search thing. So there's a problem with search, of course. If you just say, "Well, here's my problem," I'm gonna email everyone I know or put it on Slack and then they're going to put everything out and they're going to put it. If your company's not that big, obviously, you know, there's only 30 people there, then you can just ping everyone. There have been efforts, I know HP, that glorious organization, HP, in its efforts to actually not dissolve into nothing. I think they had something where, and this is tricky, right? So everyone's hard drive or their whatever, you know, I guess it was kind of their own machines. They had a script that would basically go through and compile all the terms they found and names of things, which could obviously go horribly wrong. But, you know, and go through all your emails to build out in an automatic way some sense of your knowledge. So that if you then, you know, Googled for things, you could find out this person talks about, you know, whatever it is, drumsticks all the time. So let's go and talk to them about our chicken choices. Slightly invasive? Is that what you think is fun?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it pales in comparison to like videoing each other on the board, which is what they did eventually. Isn't that what they did? They wiretapped, they tapped each other.
Both of those things ended up costing a lot of money because, somebody hacked into it and then their stats confirmed. The second part that's unconfirmed is that their competitors
model. I hope it's true. Totally deserve it. Yeah, but the board members tapped each other, right? At least more than one way, right?
Yeah, so it worked, like they had a collective surveillance on the engineer and then not all the board members, so everyone that was competing on the graph, everything that they were working on, like things
that were off the patent. Oh my god. Yeah. Inadvertently solving a search problem for the other teams, right? Okay. Oh god. I mean, just a terrible company. Anyway, so, not originally, but turned into a disaster. Like Yahoo. What is, any Yahoo users here? I have a friend who still has a yahoo.com email address. I know one who's on Wall Street who has AOL, which is getting pretty, like it's so bad, it's sort of okay. Sort of. I don't know. Wow. Oh, yeah. Right. Wow, that was amazing. Yeah. Wow, so bad. Okay, two things. We're going to have these two levels of robustness. You want the thing to not break down, and that's going to be in a sort of in a message passing situation. Right? So this thing is going to be trying to talk to itself across channels or you know, across individuals, trying to solve problems, and you don't want the thing to burst. And then even once you lose something, this is the second level of robustness. You want it to be able to hang on. This is sort of a Josh Bongard kind of thing where you rip the leg off your quadrupus and see if we can get from one side of the bench to the other, the evil robotics professors. Okay, so these are a couple of classic models of organizations, and so we'll talk about this. Those fans of economics will know about this one. So Coase is amazing. Let's talk about Coase in a second. So the nature of the firm, this is 1937, he would have been about 27 then, so he's born in 1910, English. Moved to Chicago in 1964, the University of Chicago, and he spent the rest of his career, which is a point we'll make. So this is a very famous paper. He has a couple of others, I mean many others, but this has remained one of his most famous papers. And it's just basically saying firms, it's like an existence proof of firms. It's like, oh, which of course they existed, but it's a sort of, this is why they make sense. This is why people band together and give up certain things, because of this notion that he introduced of transaction costs, right? So not all of you are doing every bit of thing, you're starting to, I mean, it makes sense. You're starting to, specialize to some extent, and things like whatever it is, the HR department does certain things for you, and accounting does certain things for you, and you don't. And your interactions with each other, you don't have to negotiate each interaction, right? And that's why you end up with vertical integration and horizontal integration. Vertical integration is good because then you aren't making, I mean, it's good and bad, right? But one of the good things, the obviously good things is you don't have to then negotiate with the people who are supplying you things and you're supplying with you. You've got the whole beginning to end bit, right? Which can lead to problems as well because, then you're removing the market from the game, and the hot dogs you're making, whether they are collateralized debt obligation type hot dogs or actual hot dogs, can end up being somewhat dubious, right? Okay, so transaction costs. You're avoiding the market, and so now you don't have to spend all day negotiating things and so on. I'm going to lose a little bit of the slide. Oh, that's a shame. Instead of just a whole bunch of people interacting, now it just gets replaced with a blob, and this is a team, right? This is yahoo.com with an exclamation point. I know I'm missing something on this slide. Come on. Wow. If you give me 1 second. Coase. Well, I guess it was just... Okay, it's just a link to him, and so let's get that. In fact, I have that sitting here. I have it sitting here. Boop, boop. Oh, thinking is hard. So here's the start of the paper, which is great. Economic theory has suffered in the past from a failure to clearly state its... This is 1937. Pretty good. Boom. He's going to have a little boom straight away. Buildings are often omitted to examine the foundations on which... Anyway, so it's pretty great. He doesn't say how big they should be. So this was an interesting problem. Like, well, should everyone be in one big firm? That's a nice piece that's missing. And it's fine. He just says they should exist, which is, well done. More Coase things. Okay, so Coase, born in 1910... Died in 2012, so he knocked out 102 years, published in 9 decades. So 30s through into the 2010s. So his last paper, I think it's his last couple of papers here in 2011 and 12, after he'd crossed the 100 threshold. So that's a decent effort. He got himself a Nobel Prize, and so Nature of the Firm is the one we're talking about here. And another... That's another big piece for him, right?
That's what he does.
This is mainly for this? Okay. Yeah. They can be a little bit specific, right? So it'll tell you about the Nobel Prize. Yeah. He was also 81 too, so he got to enjoy it for 20 years. Where is it? Ah. Oh, I'm sorry, here it is.
On the right hand side of the column, the bottom of the
set. This thing here, yeah. So, yeah, pose. Da da da. Does it actually say? All right, I mean, we could read it, but. So, kind of amazing, just amazing. But he seems to be in that category, a bit like Schelling, you know, that sort of very clear thinker, they write plainly, they're probably not horribly wrong. You know, like, so that, yeah, and a lot of it is just common, well, right? There's not some big theorem, he has a theorem, but there's not lots and lots of equations everywhere, he could probably do that. But that's not what, he doesn't live in that world completely.
I mean, what he would do actually is go out and just collect data on things and not even worry about what the things were. He had nothing he was trying to prove. He would just go out and get data on.
He would look at the world. I'm in love with him. That's great. Wow. That's amazing how hard that is for some people to do. All right, so this is good. Organizations exist. Now, there are some laws about whether they exist or not as well, but you know, we've banded together in various ways over the forever, often for just bare survival, but organizations, so corporations being able to persist, that's a rule we had to make up for ourselves because they used to be disbanded, right? They used to be, you could build a corporation to make a bridge or something, and then it would have to be taken away. Because people are smart and they're kings and queens and they want to make sure that no one else is building too much of a team, right? Yeah. No congregation in open spaces. That sort of stuff. Okay. So, a couple of extremes about organizational structure. So, I mentioned this. So, hierarchies, right? So, these are really kind of efficient things. You have a nice authority structure. It's interesting to think about how, because there's the hierarchy of, say building something, right? So you make all these widgets and then they get combined into bigger widgets and so on, right? So people are working on those things. Of course, it's a very physical kind of thing, but you can imagine papers being sort of moved up, which is something we'll talk about in a little bit, but or ideas being combined. But often there's this notion of the people are actually making things, so sort of at the bottom of the tree, and then you've got all this middle management. So it's a good question, how much middle management do you need? How many people pushing papers around? Now, these are brittle, right? If it really is a pure hierarchy, and the military is often thought of in this way, and of course it has pretty strong lines of who's above whom and so on, and you can look at org charts for all sorts of organizations, and there's this sort of thing. Although there's an infinity of vice presidents, so it's a bit hard to kind of tell. But what you can't see in these things, and to some extent social media and these communications within organizations, which you can't get out, right? I mean, they're privately held usually, so you can't see who emailed whom. The Enron email data set is something that is been around for a long time. It was a really kind of a different piece of data set because you couldn't get at that sort of thing for normal organizations, except ones that completely exploded. So that's just sort of on the web. I think it's at CMU, houses it somewhere. Just all the content, not just who emailed whom, but all the content, right? So these are brittle, right? If they're really truly hierarchies and you take off the top, then the whole thing falls apart, right? So if there's really actually communication going through this system, yeah? So like a tree, opposite thing, you cut off the trunk and then, whoop, trouble. But these things are more like, blackberry brambles or lots of mushrooms connected or something like that. The idea of a market is everyone's interacting potentially with everyone else and you're allowed to trade and whatever it is, right? So of course you're making a lot of, you really need low cost, somehow you need to have low cost interactions. But this is a socio-technical system, as I like to say. Been around for a while, right? So people plus some sort of whatever it is, telegraphs, of course, were there for a while. Paper and clay tablets are a good technical system as well, sort of writing down things. So, but these are a little more resilient. They can do, interestingly, disastrous things as well, because people still follow each other and computers can follow each other. But these are sort of these two limits we'll think about. Okay, so how are we going to do? All right, so there's this notion of that organizations could be really studied as pure hierarchies, taken to a limit here, which is, so there's these two papers, in particular by Radner and Van Zandt, where they really sort of just think of them as adding things up. So if you've got all these numbers down here, and you want to add them up so that the sort of CEO gets the sum, what's the best way of doing it? There's some burden to adding up n numbers versus n plus one numbers, so you can play around with this. It's a little bit of a game, but at least it was looking at the structure, right? Coase's original thing doesn't tell you what the internal structure is like, let alone size. And no one had really said too much, as far as we could tell at this time. This is the 90s. The first couple of papers will really look at or think about it. It's all abstract, of course, which is what I'm going to show you in general today. But they played around with this and just found different kinds of structures for adding things up. This is by David Stark, Columbia, and was thinking about real networks. And again, it's this kind of just made up thing. But I'm sorry, these are contrived examples here. His work is going in and interviewing people and looking at organizations, actually seeing how they function to some extent. That's hard. I mean, if you go and study IBM, that's going to be a hard problem, right? That is a hard problem. The government, something where you've got lots, the military, you've got lots of interactions with people. I mean, even if get up to, I mean, you could easily spend presumably a year as a sort of anthropologist at a organization studying 150 people. I mean, that would be a lot. But then if you can get in there and get their data and not release it to the other companies, maybe you can really do something. So that's it, this kind of work. And he came up with this term, heterarchy. Okay, so we've still got hierarchies, but it's really, that's a bit funny. Okay, so they're mixed, yeah. Okay, so this is an interesting one. So Chimera is one of the sort of these modern network scientists, lots of papers. With Luis Amaral and others over the years. And so this is some early stuff that I saw from him, I think, when he was just sort of starting out. So here's an interesting problem. So let's have message passing on a network. This is an abstract thing. There's going to be queuing. So this is actually something we won't put in our model, but it's a very reasonable thing. You get so many messages, you've got to deal with them all, right? So you got to deal with them one at a time. And they're just going to pile up. And there's this nice, all this lovely work on queuing theory, which is stuff is just stacking up. How long will it take to, there's also analogies to traffic jams and all sorts of things, right? So these are two limiting cases where you have a kind of a hub structure here, and this one is very randomized. So if the game is that there are randomly chosen sources and targets, right, so you're randomly choosing sources and targets and then choosing them and then sending out a message, and they're going to be like our random walkers that we've had all along. I'm pretty sure in this model they're just random walkers, right? So they're going to wander around. So that's something to think about. They're not particularly smart because there isn't a map, as we always need. We need some kind of map, as we did with all the small world stuff. They're going to, right, so it's a random search thing. But you have a couple of things here. Of course, you have the size. You have something about the network in terms of its centrality, right? So how centralized and how, like, this is sort of an extreme hierarchical kind of thing. It's just sort of a top to it. Versus this very distributed one. So you might imagine that if when the message burden kind of kicks up, right? So the message rate kicks up, there could be a shift from the kinds of networks that do better. Right, do the best, if you like. And in this, because they looked at pretty small networks, they essentially enumerated all possible structures, all searched through a pretty big space. All right, so let's see if we understand this. So kind of a phase transition thing. So you see these aren't very big. I don't know why they're L's, but that, I'm pretty sure that's the number. There should be number of nodes, only up to 160. So 160, the biggest one is white, so that's here, right? This thing. But they all have this shelf-like piece. and what's going on. So this is the rate of packet generation, right? So this is a, nothing's happening. This is where you're communicating a lot. You're trying to solve a problem, sort of thinking about this abstractly, right? So these messages are being, so European, look at that. Messages are being nucleated and sent off to a random, from a random sender to a random target. And that's happening all the time. And you're getting queuing, right? So you're getting, these messages are piling up. So that's going to be bad, right? As you go further out on that axis of packet generation, it's going to make these ones struggle. Right, very good. So the question is, so that's going to be good. This is going to be pretty good though for low packet. It's pretty clear that, you know, if you just had one in the middle and everyone's around you in a big hub, then that would be fine if you can handle it. But if you get overburdened, then you got to shift. So how quickly does it sort of shift to something that's more distributed, where you've got a lot more handling the transition? And it appears, this should be redone again, I'm sure. Maybe someone has, but that there are these transitions, right? So these are just different size systems. So these are, right, I got to explain this. Polarization. So this is, you've seen these things, so betweenness is just the standard betweenness measure that we've had. I think for nodes, it doesn't really matter. So node, so shortest paths, what's the betweenness of each node? So let's, so the thing to manufacture, that they manufacture is this polarization. So it's the maximum betweenness divided by the average betweenness. So if everyone's got the same betweenness, right? Everyone's the same, everyone feels like they're central, this will be zero, one over one, I mean, sorry, one minus one. If it's really, if there's really a hub who's massively connected and everyone else has just got their one friend that's the hub, so the star network would be the opposite, right? They'd have the largest betweenness, the number of paths, right? It'd be n minus one choose two on the top. That's how many shortest paths they're on, and these guys would be on, well, the average, yeah, the average. So, I mean, they'd have zero betweenness actually. So, but the average would be much smaller. So, anyway, so this thing would pop up. So that's what's going on here. You see sort of a transition from these hub-like ones where the polarization is really high, pretty rapidly to a distributed one, which is kind of interesting, right? It's a switch, in fact. I don't know how this goes as you sort of move up to really big networks. I mean, this piece is dropping. So that's not super awesome, but this is sort of sitting there, actually. Yeah.
So something that's kind of interesting, I just know about financial companies. So investment banks, they deal with very, very large transactions, and deal with relatively few of them. Obviously, they make their money with very, very large bond issues. And what will happen is their structure is far more hierarchical, really quite hierarchical, but it's something like a high-frequency trading firm that's dealing with many, many different types of transactions over a very quick period of time. It's much, much better. There's very little hierarchy in most
But the others have kind of made this big machine that does this thing very well, right?
Like manual trading, because people actually sitting there doing trading stuff, not HFTs, somewhere in the middle of the field.
That's interesting.
In
The HFTs, I guess I know as well that they don't, they also don't have, and this is work by Neil Johnson and Brian Tiven, they don't have a big ecology of algorithms. Because you can't, because you have to be fast, so your algorithm has to be, right, you're competing against others, so you can't add too many bells and whistles because that just slows things down. So, and that's always kind of bad, right? I mean, generally speaking, an ecology where everyone's the same, whether it's pigs or whatever, you know, like that's just not a good, that tends to go pop. It's all fine until one of them gets hurt, and because one can get hurt, they can all get hurt, yeah. That's interesting. Yeah, they can be, well, the technology is the big thing, and they can be a pretty lightweight organization, very free of economic theory too. Like no,
just almost no one knows. It's, I mean, it's
just that's not what we're doing. Yeah.
The upper management there will know about it. A lot of times, the people that have started had the idea, but
yeah,
at least the successful ones aren't just a bunch of businesses that try to do something about it.
Yeah, and if they learn the economic theory, they have to like. Just put it aside because it doesn't. They have to think about very simple things like volatility or something.
Yeah.
Just nothing special. Yeah. So this is a cool thing. I mean, it makes sense. but it was a nice piece of work. Okay, so I'm going to start talking about this model, and I guess we'll talk about it a little bit more on Thursday. And I might show you some other funny thing then, a different thing. Okay, all right, so organizations. You can't be connected to everyone else at the same time. You explode, right? So there's a typical kind of natural thing. There has to be some limit to that. You want it to be, we'd like it to be scalable, right? These are a few asks of these things. It has to be something we could get to, right? Dynamically accessible would be a nice term here. We need this, and we need our organization, so we need it to be, you know, realizable and potent here, and then have these things. Searchability, and then, right, so that you can actually find solutions to your problems, or find someone who knows something. And then these two levels of robustness. Congestion robustness, which is lots of messages being passed, you don't explode. And then connectivity, right? So that if you take out part of it, and I will show you a few things, right? So you could have kind of cascading failures where something goes wrong and then that part's taken out around it with some sort of increasing radius. Or the top could be taken out, you know, if it's still a hierarchical structure, you could imagine that. Take out the most central actors, you know, attack it in certain ways. You've seen this a lot, so the small world problem, well, we can certainly kind of think about this. We know we can get individuals to, we know we can have this sort of successful search and message passing thing, so that's a while ago, if they have identities, and we're going to move away into a different kind of version of that. All right, so it's this paper, edited by Harrison White. Harrison White went in a different direction, so he is a, he's a Columbia, you know, National Academy character, and he is a very famous sociologist who started as a physicist and did a PhD on lasers or something like that, I think. There you go. Age of 15, he went to MIT, so he's, you know, sharp. He got a PhD in when he was 25. There you go. And it's, quantum mechanical calculation of interatomic force constants in copper. This does not tell you that this person will become one of the more famous preeminent sociologists of the second half of the 20th century, but in fact that is true. So he took a course on political science, there you go, and just after he said, I'm going to do something else. And I don't know if he actually got a PhD after that in sociology. He did get a second doctorate? Where is it? Oh yeah, to begin. Did he do it? Anyway, he basically just said, I'm going to do it again, right? So he did all this stuff. And the thing about, so when I was there, we would see, he would come to our group meetings, it was a lot of fun. Where is it, down here? So, you know, and because he was a physicist, he came up with these things like vacancy chains, which is mentioned here, which is like electron holes. So when, right, so there's a hole, an electron wants to jump into it. So that was his idea for organizations, right? So someone leaves a job and then there's a hole for, someone to jump into. So lots of it. You won't know necessarily these names, but Barry Wellman, these are very famous sociologists. Is at Toronto. Behrman, who was head of the institute I was at when I was there. Kathleen Carley has just an enormous apparatus at CMU. So there are lots of, I mean, he's just had this enormous outsized influence on particularly social networks, right? Sociology's had a field of social networks since the 30s, and his students have been really giant. And so, one I didn't mention, Granovetter, right? Right, so he's just got this incredible sort of list of people. There you go. Thank you, Wikipedia. Granovetter's work provided the theoretical background from Malcolm Gladwell's The Tipping Point. Still being pursued. It might be news to these guys that they're still pursuing it, but there you go. It's just hanging around. Okay, so Harrison White, yeah, he's a big character. So one of these PNAS things where we had a proper review, but he was out. You can do this, right? You have your National Academy member help you a little bit. They don't want to look like idiots, so they won't take anything. And they maybe have two they're allowed per year where they're allowed to put forward something, and then it's reviewed properly. Anyway, strange business. Okay, so I'm just going to set this up. We won't be able to go through it. So, but there's going to be, We're gonna start with hierarchies and then add links to them. That is basically the idea. And then add links in different ways and then look at which ones perform the best. So just to sort of get in front of it, got a hierarchy, pure hierarchy. It's got a branching ratio B, so it's gonna be, you know, very, right? So fixed in its structure. Some depth L, so 0, 1, 2, so, no, sorry, 1 will be just one person. 1, 2, 3. Correct, right? So the number of nodes has to be this then, because you're adding 1 plus B squared plus B cubed, right? Up to B to the L, so that's the geometric sum that we love so much. And there'll be N minus 1 links because it's a pure tree, right? N nodes and everyone's connected. It's a spanning tree, if you like. But it's a tree, it's a tree. And then we're gonna add ties, right? So we're gonna add M links and we'll add them in different ways. So we'll end up with networks that have the same number of nodes and the same number of edges, and then we'll run things on top of them and attack them with sticks. Come at them with fruit. Okay. Very oblique Monty Python receipt. Okay, so if you think about that, means you, well, we can certainly add zero, and we can add up to this many, right? Because then there are n choose two possible links, but we've already got this many. So n choose two links minus this is this guy, right? Now, that's the fully connected version. Now, obviously, we only want to add a small number because we don't want to do anything crazy, and the typical thing we'll do is we'll add the same number of links again, right? So there's this hierarchical backbone, and then we'll add this many links on top. You know, and that change, there are a number of dials here that could change the outcome quite a bit. So this might be good to sort of just get through this piece. All right, so here's just a tiny thing, tiny example. So it's gonna be, this is the backbone, right, and dashed, right? So these are actual links, these are human, these individuals communicate with each other. So these teams, they're not teams, right? They don't talk to each other. They're at the same level, but they don't talk to each other. They just talk to this person. And in general, if you had a bigger version of this, you'd have all these leaf nodes that have one friend, right? So their message passing is not that burden. All of these will have four, which will be the branching ratio plus one, and there'll be three at the top. But as it is, if this one says, help, there is something with feathers attacking me, then this will have to, you know, right? And this is not the thing with feathers department that's over here. Then the idea is that this person who's further up in the organization kind of has a vague idea of, well, doesn't really know about the birds with feathers, and knows that the subordinates don't, right? Doesn't know anything about feathers. So they just send the message up. So this is sort of a strategy for search, because you know, before we had the Kleinberg thing where there's a big space and it's laid out and there are positions. There was our work where you're in a hierarchy and you kind of understand your identities. Here you're in a hierarchy, I mean, you have these hierarchical structures. Here you're in a hierarchy and you just know where you are, right? So you know that these people below you don't know anything about it, right? This one talks about platypuses all the time, so you just ignore them generally. But you just send a message up. That's your plan, right? You just send your message up, right? Someone tells you something and you're just like, okay. And then you move it up. So this person is always getting, if it's within the purview of this organization, they're the ones that pass the message, right? They're the ones. So you can imagine unwrapping this thing and making it, you know, span out in that way and being like a proper kind of tree structure like that. They're the central hub, which is not a good idea for a CEO. That's why they have people.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is this queuing thing where they go pop.
Yeah.
Right. That's right. So that's what we'll test. So this is obviously really bad. If you know what you're doing, right, and you're reporting, you're saying, yes, the machine is working well, I have three platypuses for you, you know, like that's, right, like yesterday, like you asked me, right, like that's all good, that's all working well, yeah? But as soon as it, you know, something goes completely berserk here, then, and you have to sort of solve a new problem, then there's going to be a lot of information piling up at this character here, and they'll be overburdened, and they'll give up. They'll go pop. So the chimera thing, they had this, my hilarious attempts, they had queuing, right? So you'd sort of see the thing, you'd see this one actually just fail, right? Because the messages would be piling up and piling up and piling up. You can look at it fail. Whereas the model I'll tell you about, they handle all the messages they get. It's just a question of how many they get at a particular time, right? So we'll just So it's another way of doing it. You just say, okay, well, they're running at 1,000 messages a minute. Obviously, they would have exploded by this point. Like, if you want this communication pattern to be running, here's the most burdened node, and here's how much they're handling, right? They would have gone pop before we got to this, but if that makes sense. So, all right. Obviously, this is an important organization solving important problems to do with strange things. Okay, so this would be, so here I'll just illustrate the possible examples, and we'll have a model that produces these limiting cases, right? So this is just the backbone, if you like. And on top of it, we're going to add links, and we'll add, we'll try to add the same number in each one. But this will be a team-based one. So we're building, we've just got three people in each potential team. So now they're all friends, well, not friends, but they talk to each other, right? So that's a reinforcement of that, and that's a very sensible kind of structure. Yes? Yeah, so there's an underlying thing, and now you can just add. And in this case, I'm not sure if I'll preserve. In this case, we're going to add 12 links, m equals 12. We're going to add 12 links, and there are possible places we can put that. And so here's one extreme, because we've chosen a nice little cartoon, where it's what we will call team-based networks. We've just absolutely reinforced them locally. You're adding, right? So you got the hierarchy, a pure hierarchy, and then we're going to add links on top. Now, the hierarchy will turn out in some ways to just be such a strong structure that it's not really going to be enormously transformative, but you'll see that there are, depending on what we're testing, there'll be better things. You know, when we add links, it's going to help. So you imagine a much bigger version of this, right? Much, much bigger version, renormalized out. These don't look enormously different, right? If your message here about the alarming thing with a beak doesn't have to go to the top anymore. So you can see this does help, at least, just right at the top, right? So it comes up here. This person knows the main character, but also knows the heads of these other departments and sends you over to this one. So that saves, so that already is going to relieve some burden. But if this was, 10 levels, yes, the team, pure team-based version, this top tier below the head would all be connected, fully connected perhaps, so they'd be able to kind of circumvent that top thing. This one can then just go and live in the Cayman Islands, right, because they don't have to, they've organized very well, and just yell at people perhaps, maybe that works too. But they can ignore the sort of the runnings of these things, yeah. So random networks, well, it's just a mess, right? You're just going to add links between random people, fine? So we can just overlay that. And the way to do it, structurally is each one just gets the same weight. Each node will get the same weight, and we're doing exactly what we did with Edish Rennie, just on top, but there is a hierarchy underneath. So that could help, if you need a message, if this was you play basketball with this character over here, and they're really into this hummingbird thing, Well, they talk about taxidermy of things with feathers all the time. So maybe you would talk to them, right? Taxidermy, so 19th century, right? Wow. This is a weird one, but it just sort of arises naturally from at least from models, which is within your division, you don't know anyone, but you're randomly connected across. It's just going to be sort of a weird outcome. So what this does is it helps you really like search, random connections are the things that help you search very far, right? They give you weird ways to get into things, and they're useful. But as we got with the Kleinberg story, you need connections kind of at all scales logarithmically, and it's the same as having golf sticks, everything from a wedge to the one wood, right? You need to have different tools, right? So you can get to different... I mean, you could use a wood for the whole thing, but it would be a mess. What's this guy? Some guy from college golf, the worst. But all his sticks have the same length. This is apparently anathema to people who make golf sticks. Anyway, he just decided he's going to have everything is going to be exactly the same length. That's not what you do, right? A wedge would be swollen. The wood is like back here because you just whoop. So they're all the same. Anyway, sorry, I just thought it was interesting. Anyway, he's pretty weird. He's walking around with this set of sticks that are all exactly the same length, and he had to get them specially made. So then it just means his swing is always the same. Yeah. Because you're just grooving your, you know, right? I mean, so like training to do anything. It doesn't matter what you're doing, right? It could be, you know, physics equations or whatever. You're just trying to train yourself over and over and over to do the same thing. Can you get the yips with math? Can you get the yips? The yips. The yips is when you can't, right? The yips is when you're particularly putting, right? This happens in golfers. They just can't putt anymore. It just all falls apart, and they, you know, they hit it like 10 feet off the green or something. They've just lost. I mean, there are famous things like the pianist. Who was that? Well, that's something else, I think, isn't it? That is a really interesting thing. And those kinds of mathematicians are very funny to me. They can't add basic numbers up, but they're off with algebraic geometry or something. It really is funny. Yeah. I don't know what that is. Is it just dismissive of lower forms of counting?
I think it's overthinking.
God. I guess so, right. They're trying to do a Lebesgue integral of the, you know, the tip. How can I? Yeah, right. I've decided to conformally map. Right, whatever, right. It's like, oh my God. Shut up. Yeah, right. So the little thing that tells you that it's 15% is this, 20% is 25%, it's for the mathematicians. It's not for normal people. And cheapskates, I guess. All right, there's this one. Yeah, but the yips is just a thing. I guess maybe it comes from golf, but maybe it comes from something else, actually. Yeah. Oh, Chuck, what was that guy's name? Chuck, he's a third baseman, I think, for the Yankees in the 90s. Couldn't throw anymore. Just couldn't throw. Just threw it into the crowd all the time. And it was a disaster. Knobloch. Is that right? It was a disaster. The poor guy, and everyone's like, oh my God. Because it had just gone wrong. He's just like, he just missed by 20 feet. And they had to get it all reconstructed. Anyway. But it's an interesting thing. I mean, there's that, but maybe you get it with solving problems as well. Music's the same. Music can get it. I can't remember. I mean, I feel like this is more of a neural problem, but there was one guy who lost his use. He couldn't use one hand on a piano for about 3 decades or something like that. My wife would be able to remind me what that was. Yeah, because you use something over and over and over again, right? And do it exactly the same way. That actually, it's great up until it breaks a little bit, right? I mean, there's a similar sort of thing for heart rate, right? So if your heartbeat is absolutely periodic, it looks like a really good plan, but that's actually bad. You want to see a little bit of chaotic fluctuation around it. I don't know. I think that's sort of a... Anyway, so core periphery. So we're just going to... It's too small a network to do the right thing here, but we're just going to reinforce the top. So if it was a huge pyramid here, you'd be just adding tons of links up the top. And so this is a term from, yeah, so right? So you just reinforce that. So it's going to be good for all these messages coming up and being passed down, but it will still take a while. So that's a pretty good network, actually, especially in the context of a hierarchy. But given that we've, you know, said there's going to be a hierarchy, this is going to be pretty strong. And then what I'll call multiscale networks, which are more in this Kleinberg game of things where there is some spreading of the links going down. Yes, there's some at the top, but there's some distribution of them going down. So the game will be, you've got so many links, you can add them, and we'll have to sort of dial between these. Let's see, so teams, you could just reinforce teams, you could just add them randomly. You could add them randomly, but only across these big major divisions. You could just reinforce the top, or you could do something a little bit like this, where you're biased towards the top, but you're gonna spread it down. And this is what we'll talk about on Thursday, and then we'll move on to some other thing that I'll find in a box. But here's sort of this basic model, right? The plan will be, we want to write a little probabilistic thing that will choose the location of two nodes to connect. And so how do we define two nodes in this hierarchy? Well, we have to find the position of the lowest common ancestor. So we want something to specify that. And then we want to specify how far each one is below that lowest common ancestor. So you want something that selects, right? So it's a weird die. You roll it, and it comes back, and it has three numbers. or you find it and you look on top because it's really small, and it has three numbers, and there'll be the depth of the lowest common ancestor and the depth of the first one and the second one. And then you add a link if you can. And you do that again and again with your big, funny die. Anyway, this turns out to do some good things. It's fun. It was concocted in a basement, basically, with no sunlight. So that may come through as well. But I remember actually, so I sort of came through, you know, it's like running through the hallway saying, look, I have this, you know, and my two colleagues said, well, I'll talk about Chuck Sable a little bit more. I've heard a lot about Duncan, like, yes, just write it up. I think it was desperation at that point. But anyway, it was fun. It was a fun program. Okay. So that's good. That's a good place to stop. Thank you, people. If you want to talk, you know, there's office hours. And